God gave me a message to share this morning, and I'm excited to share it. So would you pray with me as we begin this morning? Amen. Father, I want to thank you for this opportunity to preach your word. Your word is alive and full of power. It's sharper than any two-edged sword. And Father, I want to thank you for the message you gave me today to glorify and bring glory to your name and to bless the mothers that are here today. So, Father, I pray, Holy Spirit, you will come and fall upon us. Let us have a special time before you this morning. Let us have a time of praise and worship as we hear your word. Let us praise your name. And let us be thankful in our hearts for the mothers that you've given us. We give you thanks and praise for those that are here and those that are in glory with you. We give you all praise and glory in Jesus' name. And all God's people said,
Amen.
Amen. Amen. So what about the mothers? My mom went to be with the Lord when I was 27. And God has given me so many moms since then, I just don't have enough place to put them all. My family teases me and says, when you get to heaven, all these beautiful young ladies are going to surround you. And I said, really? What's that about? And they said, all these elderly women that you prayed with and visited and went to the rest homes, when they get up there, they're all going to be young and beautiful again. I think all I'm going to want to do when I get to heaven is fall on my face and worship the Lord. Praise God. Turn with me, if you would, to Proverbs chapter 31. Proverbs, the 31st chapter. The Lord has so much to say in Scripture about mothers. So much to say. How many of you love your mom today? Praise God. Hallelujah. Love my mom. My mom is a real lady. There's a difference between a woman and a lady. She was a real lady. The Greek community where I was born in Utah called her the Golden Mother. The Golden Mother. My dad, when I was 6 years old, my dad left, moved to another state, and my mom raised myself and four other siblings. Never went out on a date, never did anything but take care of us children until we all graduated from high school. And it was shortly after that she got Alzheimer's and then passed away. So my mom has a great reward in heaven, and if your mom is in heaven, she has a great reward. Those of you who have lost your moms and now they're with the Lord, you can rejoice that they're waiting for you. And that'll be a great day of rejoicing. Amen? So Proverbs chapter 31, starting with verse 10. The Bible says, who can find a virtuous woman? Her price is far above rubies. And then verse 25 says, strength and honor are her clothing, and she shall rejoice in the time to come. She opens her mouth with wisdom, and in her tongue is the law of kindness. She looks well to the ways of her household and does not eat the bread of idleness. Her children rise up and call her blessed. And her husband also praises her. Many daughters have done virtuously, but you excel them all. Now favor is deceitful, and beauty is vain. But a woman that fears the Lord, she will be praised. Amen?
Amen.
Give her the fruit of her hands, and let her own works praise her in the gates. Now, throughout the New Testament, we have some statements that have to do with the mother of Jesus. Most of them have something to do with the main body of the story, but certainly with the purpose, our Lord puts in little statements such as, and the mother of Jesus was there. Or, Mary, the mother of Jesus, was there. Or, the mother of Jesus stood outside, as in Matthew chapter 12, verse 47. So it's obvious that our Lord wanted us to know that his mother was always there. And I thank God for you moms. You're always there.
Amen.
You're always there. There's no doubt on center stage in the Bible is the Lord Jesus Christ. He's the central figure in Scripture. He's the central figure of this book. He is the center ring of performance. He is the hero. Though the spotlight was focused on him and the attention was towards him, standing in the shadows, mostly in the shadows, was his mother, Mary. It didn't matter what our Lord was doing. His mother was there. For example, Jesus had performed a miracle. He had cast out a devil and had just preached a sermon about the unpardonable sin. And the Bible simply says at the end of those scriptures, the mother of Jesus stood outside. You'll recall in John chapter 2, Jesus performed his first miracle. It was the wedding at Cana. He had never yet opened a blind eye. He had never yet caused a lame person to walk. He had not caused the dumb to speak yet. Nor had he caused the dead to rise from the dead. Nor the blind to see or the deaf to hear. He had never yet reached out and lifted anyone out of a bed of sickness. The spotlight of eternity is about to focus on Jesus in John chapter 2 for the first time. But before it does, the first line of the verse of the first miracle that Jesus ever performed simply says, and the mother of Jesus was there. The light is on Jesus, but the mother of Jesus was there. The light is on the Son of God, but the Holy Spirit prompted John the Apostle to write these words. The mother of Jesus was there. In John 19:25, we have it told that Jesus is on the cross. God in the flesh is dying for our sins. He who knew no sin has become sin for you and me. The nails are in his hands and feet. The crown of thorns is on his brow. The Bible says, now there stood by the cross the mother of Jesus. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. I thank God for the Holy Spirit. He just reminded me that I didn't release the children. So kind of like your mother. So, Lord, okay. Children, you are released for Sunday school. God bless you. You got to hear some of the sermon anyway. God bless you, Angela. Amen. There goes half the church. April, thank you for helping. God bless you. You hang around here long enough, you know we don't go by the clock or by any rules. I think we've pretty much broken them all by now. I want to bring you back to this. Jesus' first miracle, John chapter 2, he's at a wedding. They run out of wine. By the way, I've looked up the word in John chapter 2 that says wine. And it's the Greek word oinos. And my grandparents said that word many, many times. My grandfather made wine. Now, biblical wine is not very strong. You would have to drink wine all day long in order to get a buzz on biblical wine. The wine we have today will thrash you after a glass and a half. But biblical wine was not that way. And that's why the Bible says, woe unto those who tarry long at the wine. In Acts chapter 2, when the disciples were filled with the Holy Ghost, men thought they were drunk. And Peter argued and said, how can they be drunk? It's 9 o'clock in the morning. Hey, I've seen a lot of drunks at 9 in the morning. But in Bible times, you would have had to drink all day long to get drunk. So Jesus made wine. He had them get some water pots and pour water into it. And he touched them and they became wine. And the master of the feast said, wow, most hosts serve the best wine first and leave the bad for the end. But this one has brought the best wine at the very end. his first miracle. The spotlight of all history was about to shine on Jesus. And the Holy Ghost said, the mother of Jesus was there. After his death and his resurrection, Jesus has gone back to heaven. He is at the right hand of the Father, and there were 120 disciples praying in the upper room. Pentecost is about to come. The Bible says the Holy Spirit fell on them, and it appeared unto them as tongues of fire. And they all began to speak with other tongues, the scripture says. The miracle there was that every person in the place at that time heard them speak in their own language. It was though I were to speak Spanish. I know some Spanish words. Comida. Which is probably on a lot of our minds right now. Gracias, Señor. Vida eterna, life eternal. And I know a few others. But what if I spoke those words and you heard them in your own language? That was the miracle that happened in Acts chapter 2. People heard them speaking in another language that they had never spoken. But they heard them in their own language. Those from Mesopotamia heard them in their language. Those from Italy heard them in their language. Those from Greece heard them in their language. Those from Russia heard them in their language. Every nation under the earth was there, and they all heard them in their own language. God is the God of miracles.
Amen.
3,000 people are about ready to get saved.
Amen.
Peter gets up to preach, and the power of God is about to fall on the church. The message of Jesus is about to be preached in that upper room at the prayer meeting. And the Bible records this. Mary, the mother of Jesus, was there. She was always there. You could always count on the mother of Jesus. She was that little silent gal of Nazareth, the poor little humble girl from the hills of Nazareth who came to Bethlehem and then found no room to deliver her baby. There was only a stable because there was no room for them at the inn. The light hardly ever shined on Mary. She hardly ever gets any attention. She's in the shadows. When Jesus performs a miracle, standing in the shadows is his mother Mary. The Bible says, but Mary kept all these things and pondered them in her heart. Mary never said much. She just pondered those things in her heart. Only God knows. How many of you mothers have spent countless hours pondering things in your hearts? Praying for your children. Praying for your husbands. Loving your family. Hoping for your kids. How many of us here have considered the time and energy and sacrifices in prayer that have been offered up for us by our mothers and by our grandmothers? When I was a little boy in Christ, Utah, I slept in the back room of my grandmother's house. And when I would get up, she would be on her knees praying. She had a little... I just thought it might be the Holy Spirit. But it's okay. I want to make sure I wasn't going to get wet. God knows how many hours you've spent. I know my grandma Nell, she had a little candle that she lit in a little red vase, a picture of a cross, Jesus kneeling by it. Hours and hours and hours and hours and hours and hours she prayed. It was 28 years old before I found Jesus. My grandma had long been gone. She passed away when I was in high school. But she prayed. Moms, don't you dare think that your prayers are in vain. We're here because of your prayers.
Amen.
Grandmas, don't you give up. The Bible says we walk not by sight, we walk by faith.
Amen.
We don't walk by what we see, we don't walk by what we hear.
That's right.
We walk by what we know.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. I want you to think about Moses, who who took a rod and held it over the Red Sea and walked over on dry ground. For 2 million Jews followed him, and behind Moses was his sweet little mother, Jochebed, who before that had protected a little baby boy by placing him in a little basket in the Nile River, and God rescued him. Think about John the Baptist, who said, "He," that's Jesus, "must increase and I must decrease. Behold, the Lamb of God," he said in John, "who takes away the sin of the world." The Bible says that among them that are born of women, there is no greater than John the Baptist. But behind John the Baptist was that elderly mother, Elizabeth, who waited on God way up into her 80s and had a little boy that God told his father, Zacharias, "You shall name him John." And that mother prayed. Think about the wise men who came to visit Jesus in Bethlehem. They brought gifts of gold, frankincense, and myrrh. But Mary stayed in the shadows. She stayed in the shadows in that little stable. Think about Hannah in the book of Samuel, first chapter, who had no child. She went into the temple and prayed and begged God for a child, promising that that child would be given back to God. Hannah, now a mother, kept her promise so that God would have preeminence, so that God would be glorified through the prophet Samuel, whom she gave to the Lord at a very young age. She denied herself so that the Lord would have first place in her life. As Jesus was questioning the teachers and the doctors in the temple, the light shone upon him. When he cast out demons in his miracles, the attention was on Jesus. But don't forget, Mary was in the shadows. So mothers, God wants you to know today that you're owed a great reward. And that reward is waiting for you. Some of it here on earth, but most of it in heaven. Your prayers are not in vain. Jeremiah 33:3 says, "Call unto me, I will answer you. I will show you great and mighty things which you know not." Joey, Jennifer, you're here today because your mama prayed. You're here today because she prayed. I'm here today because my mama and my grandmother prayed. You're here today because your mama prayed. Your grandmother prayed. Your labor is not in vain, ladies. The Bible says, "Thanks be unto God who gives us the victory through Jesus Christ our Lord." You have the victory coming.
Amen.
The Bible says, "Therefore be steadfast, be unmovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord. For as much as you know, your labor is not in vain in the Lord."
Amen.
It's not in vain. You stay on your knees. You continue to pray. You'll see great miracles happen.
Yes. Amen.
Your love is not in vain. In fact, the Bible says, "By this shall all men know that you are my disciples, by the love that you show one to another." Show me a mom that doesn't love. Mom's love, that's what God put in their hearts. Ladies, your work is not in vain. The Bible says in Hebrews 6:10, "If God is not unrighteous to forget our work and our labor of love, which we have shown towards his name, and that you moms have ministered unto the children of God and continue to do so." You have to remember that those children come from the Lord. Amen? The Bible says children are a heritage from the Lord, and the fruit of his womb is your reward. Because God sends those children into the world. If you read Psalm 139, you will read these words: "While I was yet in my mother's womb, you knew me.
Amen.
My substance was not hidden from you. In the very lowest parts of the earth where I was formed, you saw all of my parts even before they became." God knows everything about us.
Amen.
Moms, your giving isn't in vain either. The Bible says, give, and it shall be given unto you. Good measure, pressed down, shaken together, and running over. Don't you dare give up praying, moms.
Amen.
You continue to pray for your children.
Yes.
The scripture says in Acts chapter 16, 31, believe in the Lord Jesus Christ, and you shall be saved, and your household.
Amen.
God gives that good promise. He says, you pray, and you get saved, and your household will get saved as well.
Amen.
Problem is, it's not in our time, it's in God's time.
Right.
But God gives us this great promise in Ecclesiastes chapter 3, verse 11. The Bible says, he will make everything beautiful in his time. Yet he has placed the world in our hearts that we will not know the work that God is making from the beginning to the end. That's why we shouldn't look at what we see. We should believe in what we know.
Amen.
Because the Bible says God is faithful in 1 Thessalonians chapter 5 and verse 24. Faithful is he who calls you, who also will do it. Your prayers aren't in vain. Your labor is not in vain. Your love is not in vain. Your work is not in vain. Your giving is not in vain. Neither is your hope in vain. Turn with me, if you would, to Romans chapter 5. If you'll turn to the book of Romans with me, Romans, the 5th chapter. Your hope is not in vain. The Bible says in Romans 5, verse 1, therefore being justified, just as if I've never sinned, therefore being justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ, by whom also we have access by faith into this grace. Moms, that's what you need. You need to access God's grace by faith. Keep praying. Keep praying. God will answer every single prayer. He never misses even one. Into this grace where we stand and rejoice in the hope of the glory of God. And not only so, but we glory in our tribulations as well, knowing that tribulation works patience. Patience is working experience, and experience works hope. And hope does not make ashamed, because of the love of God that is shed abroad in your hearts by the Holy Ghost, which is given unto all of us.
Amen.
We can have hope. Amen.
Amen.
So your hope and your prayers and your labor and your love and your work and your giving are all going to bring you a great reward. And not only you mothers, but every single person who names the name of Christ, who prays and reaches out to God in prayer, God will bless you. God will answer your prayers. The scripture says, call unto me, I will answer you. He tells us, behold, I am the God of heaven and earth. Is there anything too hard for me? There's nothing too hard for the Lord.
Amen.
Praise God. So what reward is Jesus talking about? Turn with me to John chapter 14. There's a day coming, a great reunion, a reunion in the air, in the clouds. The Bible talks about it in 1 Thessalonians chapter 4 as you're turning to John 14, where he says, the Lord himself shall descend from heaven with a shout, and with the voice of the archangel and the trumpet of God, the dead in Christ shall rise first. Then we which are alive and remain shall be caught up together with them to meet the Lord in the air. And so shall we ever be with the Lord.
Amen.
The great reunion, John chapter 14. He tells us, let not your hearts be troubled. You believe in God? Believe also in me. For in my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. But I go to prepare a place for you.
Amen.
And if I go, I will come again to receive you unto myself, that where I am, you may be also. And the way I go, you know, and the way you know. Now Thomas said to him, Lord, how can we know what way you're going? How can we know the way? Jesus said unto him, I am the way, I am the truth, and I am the life. No man comes unto the Father but by me. That's the way. Jesus Christ our Lord. John chapter 14, verse 25 says, "These things have I spoken unto you, yet being present with you," Jesus said. "But the Comforter, which is the Holy Ghost, whom the Father will send in my name, he will teach you all things and bring all things to your remembrance, whatever I have said unto you. Peace I leave with you, my peace I give unto you, not as the world gives, will I give unto you. Let not your heart be troubled, neither let it be afraid. You have heard now how I said unto you, I am going away, and I am coming again to you. If you love me, you would rejoice, because I said I go unto the Father, for my Father is greater than I. And now I have told you before it comes to pass, that when it does come to pass, you might believe." Do you believe? Do you believe?
Yes.
If you're here today and you don't believe, trust Jesus today. Ask him to come into your life. It's that simple. On November 4th, 1980, I had no Bible. I had no preacher. I had no person in my house. All I had was a smoking gun, as Clark read this morning. But the Holy Ghost, who reminded me to release the children this morning, also came and said, "It's your time." Jesus is real. Ask him to come in, and I'll prove it to you. And I asked Jesus to come in, and to my shock and amazement, my entire life changed.
Amen.
If you're here today and you don't know Christ, ask him to come in. Ask him to come in today. Ask him to come in. You can mark this down as a miracle, because I'm done. It's the only time it's going to happen in this church. I just want to say God bless you, mothers. May God make his face to shine upon you. May he give you peace.